So why would you train them to do something exactly the same and basically replicate all of your successes, but also all of your errors? And so the idea of developing the unique joint value proposition is that if you can do something different, then automatically the partner will not be going to all of its customers offering what you offer. They will offer something a little bit different. And then the competition, to start with, will not know how to compete. By the time they've figured it out, if they can, because they'll have to change their entire value proposition to compete with your local partner. If they actually manage to do that, it's probably too late. And the channel partner's already got the customer to think in terms of their value proposition. You know, do they have to have education? Do they have to have local support? Must the local support be in their local language? Which is very important, of course, in Europe, where there's so many different languages.
Hello, welcome, and thank you for tuning into Channel Voices, the podcast for future channel leaders, where we learn the ins and outs of partner ecosystems through casual conversations with channel professionals from a variety of industries, partner types, and geographies. My name is Maciek, and I'm your host. Philip Strange, welcome to Channel Voices.
Thank you, Maciej. It's very, very, very kind of you to ask me, and it's a pleasure to be here.
Thank you very much for joining me today. We will be talking about joint value proposition in the channel, which is a very interesting subject on its own. But before we get in there, could you tell us a little bit about yourself and what have you done in the channel so far? What's your background experience, please?
Okay, so I'm originally from the UK, but I've lived in Spain since 1996, in Barcelona. As a young salesman, I used to sell computer hardware maintenance contracts, which were a minimum of 12-month terms. And then we started getting inquiries for short-term contracts. And for one reason or another, the boss said to me, why don't you handle those? I don't think anybody else was interested, to be honest. I don't think they thought that there was any money in it. So I started getting into these short-term contracts and learned how to negotiate shorter-term deals. I learned how to read contracts in a lot more efficiency and detail. And inside of about 6 months, I ended up with 20% of my monthly target already done every month, thanks to these short-term contracts. And this was basically selling through the channel. And I thought, this is really great, you know. I can really live with this. Because I already knew how much I was going to earn at the start of every month. And then when I came to Spain, I opened up Mercury Interactive's Spanish subsidiary, but just in Spain. And then after 3 years, I got an opportunity to go to their competitor, Segway Software, but with a much bigger job, which was running channel in the whole of Europe. And I'm a kind of a European, and I don't just speak Spanish, I muddle my way through French as well. And they said that, as you're an expat living, you live outside of your home country, you are more qualified and you have a broader perspective of European culture than if you lived in your own country doing that. So we think you're better qualified to do this than someone who lives in their own country. You live outside your country. And so I took the job and it all started there. I'm still in touch with a lot of my original resellers from Segway and subsequently also from Gomez, from Keynote Systems, which was acquired by Dynatrace, from Verizon / Edgecast CDN, which was acquired by Limelight Networks. So I've managed European channel for those four companies. And then when I left Verizon, I took a little bit of a sideways step into digital marketing, but I'm a software guy. So I came back into software and I designed a worldwide channel program for Alice Biometrics, and then I did it again recently for Ultimate Suite. And the great thing is all these relationships, all these management roles are different because the channels are different. Is it GSI? Is it an ISV play? Is it just pure reselling? You learn that the channel partners are not just interested in the margin. They're interested in the services they can build around it. And that's what gave birth to the idea of a unique joint value proposition.
Excellent. Thank you very much. You've absolutely done quite a bit in the channel. You have experienced a lot of different partner types and different go-to-market strategies and learned that, yes, relationship building is of huge, huge importance, and margin isn't everything for the partners, right?
Yeah. Just the 20 years, Mashi.
Yeah. Well, that spans quite a long time. As we get into the subject now of that unique joint value proposition, how would you define it from your experience and what you see happening in the market?
Okay, so my definition of that is when the partner is able to offer something which they cannot offer without you, but you cannot offer that without them. It's totally unique to you two as a couple, right? And so this could be a specific type of professional service. It could be access to government contracts, because you can't get into those government contracts. You don't have security clearance. It has to be done on the paper of the partner, right? So is there anything really which allows you to offer something different in the market? And the reason to do that is that if you think that when you train a channel partner to sell your offering, if you train them to do exactly what your salespeople do, then in their local market, the local competition or the regular competition of the vendor, they'll know exactly what the channel partner is going to say. So why would you train them to do something exactly the same and basically replicate all of your successes, but also all of your errors? And so the idea of developing the unique joint value proposition is that if you can do something different, then automatically the partner will not be going to all of its customers offering what you offer. They will offer something a little bit different, and then the competition, to start with, will not know how to compete. By the time they've figured it out, if they can, because they'll have to change their entire value proposition to compete with your local partner, if they actually manage to do that, it's probably gonna be too late, and the channel partner's already got the customer to think in terms of their value proposition. You know, do they have to have education? Do they have to have local support? Must the local support be in their local language, which is very important, of course, in Europe, where there's so many different languages. And so if you have a local channel partner who can support a customer, first of all, in their local language, that also forms part of the joint unique value proposition, right? But if they've got some kind of different combination of products, and they match those products with your offering, then automatically your regular competition worldwide won't be able to do anything about that, because they will then have to also offer those products, which could be of competing vendors to them, and they'll never be able to do that. So it helps the channel partner get to first base, and it eliminates competition.
Perfect. But that comes with quite a few challenges as I think about it. The process of recruiting partners, that already is, you know, there's a little bit more digging to be done. Identifying the right partners, evaluating them, and obviously the partner has to do exactly the same thing, right? They have to evaluate the vendor, the product that they're selling, and what type of services can they wrap around them. And then further to that, how easy would it be to replicate that? You know, if you, let's say, you start with 5 partners, you really got that unique value proposition with them, but you do want to scale, you do want to have other partners, you do want to enter different markets, other countries with different languages. How easy is it to replicate?
Well, it's not as hard as it sounds. I think that to begin with, when you're in the recruitment phase, I think the biggest mistake vendors make is they'll say, well, these guys are interested, let's send them a contract, without thinking further, right? They don't talk to the partner about, well, tell us a little bit about why you want to do this. What's your vision of the relationship? I recently turned down a very, very good looking partner simply because after I asked this question several times, the only reason they wanted to work with us was that they wanted our logo on their website and they wanted it as an alternative to their chosen vendor in the same space. And I'm not interested in that. I want to be the only vendor in that space. In terms of the recruitment process, it actually helps to qualify out partners that are never going to sell anything for you. Because the worst thing you can have is 400, this is the age-old complaint. We've got 400 channel partners, only 20 of them sell anything. Well, that's because you recruited 380 under the wrong criteria, right? You wasted your time with all the rest of them. By introducing this idea, you get the channel partner to think automatically, well, why are we doing this? How can we take this to market? How can we make this into a going concern and a real business for ourselves, which is what both sides want, right? And then if you get a use case, for example, let's take, for example, we get a use case in London, right, in the UK, and it's a unique value proposition for the UK. There's nothing stopping you repeating that in Spain, in Chile, in the United States, because the channel partner isn't going to go to those countries and try and do the same over there, right?
Right.
So you can get different use cases which you can replicate in different countries. But the other thing is you can have multiple channel partners in the same territory. But if they've all got a different value proposition, they're not going to bump into each other. So ideally what you want is for the channel partner to be talking to the same person about the same thing, right?
Yes.
That's what you're looking for is your ideal customer profile. But if they are off, if one partner is, let's say, for example, they focus on security and your product is about automating stuff, okay? If they're wrapping automation with some kind of security play, it's different from a company which is offering your stuff to the same market, but they offer automation with a data analysis play. They're
right.
Not going to be talking to the same people. They're going to be offering different things. They may even find different opportunities in the same account and never even know that they're actually working with the same customer simultaneously.
So would it be fair to say that it all comes down to specialization and finding the right niche?
Oh, absolutely, yeah. And also, I think you're talking about use cases, right? So
yeah.
Every vendor depends on their channel partners to bring them different use cases. And once again, just starting the discussion of unique joint value proposition starts off the conversation of use cases. And so how do you go to market? How would you work with our product? What's your vision of the relationship and how this would play out over the next 2 or 3 years, right? And this automatically then raises the level of the conversation and raises the visibility of the conversation to leadership in the channel partner. Because if you don't have the CEO involved in some way in this discussion, then who's behind this when things go wrong?
Right.
Right?
Yeah.
And so it's this, if you think about any channel partner, let's forget about the big GSIs for the moment. If you think about a decent channel partner in a decent territory, they've got like 200 people and they've got, I don't know, 10 or 12 salespeople. A company of 10 or 12 salespeople, how often do you think the CEO gets involved in strategic decisions?
Yeah.
Right? There's only 10 guys selling, right? They may even report directly to him. And so he is absolutely, definitely the guy who is going to be in charge of the strategy. He's absolutely, definitely the guy across whose desk the piece of paper goes to say, right, these are the guys we're looking at to partner with. What do you think, right? If he doesn't have a vision of how that's going to work, then you're already wasting your time, right? And if he doesn't get involved, you're wasting your time. So this just tabling the discussion raises the level of the conversation and solidifies the future relationship.
And I suppose it does come down to, you know, versus the maybe, I don't want to say legacy type of channel where it was all about, you know, pushing boxes through the partners. Right.
Yeah.
Or selling just licenses without any additional services or without that joint value proposition. But when it is unique, right, I suppose for the partner, it is that potential of growing together with the vendor. Right. And that's what it's all about. They don't want to just, you know, say, yeah, with this vendor, we do 10% of our turnover and we're happy with that. It's always about how do I use this unique relationship with this vendor to offer something to our customers that is going to help us grow as a company as well.
That's right. And let's just think about the way the channel partner thinks, right? you're not going to be able to make them change their modus operandi. If they specialize in security, in IT security, that's what they're always going to do. Their CEO is probably an IT security geek, right? He's immersed in the IT security world. He recruits guys who understand IT security. All their pre-sales people understand IT security. You're never going to go in there and get them to sell something which is not IT security related. So why not just take the smooth handle here and say, how can we wrap what we've got into your IT security play? Because that's what they're always going to do, right? Their customers are used to them talking about IT security. So if they can wrap your offering or wrap their IT security expertise around your offering, then you'll almost sell it by default just because they show up. And that'll make them happy. They're looking to grow via increasing the number of people in the company, increasing the number of consultants, increasing the ProServe revenue. Can they get a margin? Yeah, sure they can. But, you know, that's not going to be the be-all and end-all for them. What they want to do is make it sticky, get an extra guy onto that site, maybe have three people there, then they pick up more business. I mean, it's a win-win for everybody. And that's what channel partnerships are all about, right?
Yeah. Is it important to incorporate end customer feedback to reshape or tweak the unique joint value proposition?
Well, I think, yeah, obviously, the end user customer, they'll buy what they want, right? And they won't buy something that is not going to serve them. And so, yeah, it's very important to get their feedback. But I think, on the other hand, when you're going into a new market, the person that knows what those customers want is actually your channel partner. That's why you're going to hire them, okay? They're going to tell you, well, in our territory, we've got 20 customers who are interested in this. If we can do something with your offering and wrap our services around it, then we will definitely be able to sell to them. Yeah, so in that way, that's how you get that feedback.
Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay. And in terms of roadblocks that might appear during that journey with that partner where we have, mm-hmm. you know, developed a unique joint value proposition, is there anything that is kind of consistent across the board, or is every partner different when it comes to those roadblocks?
I'd say they're all different. I mean, you're talking about a unique joint value proposition, mm. right? And any roadblock you get is going to be unique to that partner. But if what you're talking about makes sense to them, and obviously it comes from them, doesn't come from you. You're saying to them, how can we go to market together? This is how we go to market with everybody else, or we've gone to market with other partners. You offer a different type of service. How do you see this working? And this is all part of the recruitment process. If they say, well, we don't see it working, or we're not sure we can do that, then that's actually a red flag. You say, well, you know, maybe you're not the right partner for us, right? So you cross all these bridges in the early stages before you actually get to contract, so that you don't get that problem once you start off, right? Because this is all part of the recruitment process.
Basically, you take it head on while you're having those very early discussions.
That's why you need to get the leadership involved and ask them, what's your vision? What's your vision of working with us? How are you going to go to market? How are your services going to add value to what we've got? What are you going to say to the customers? How are you going to sell this? Who do you normally talk to? All the usual questions. And then it comes out that they've got actually an idea to do something different, which differentiates them from you. Because really, if they're talking to the customer about a solution, the customer doesn't even need to know you exist, because they're signing the deal on the partner paper. They can even say, oh, by the way, we use this company's products to do this. Just sign here. And that's the end of it, right? Because what they're offering is something completely different. And that's the whole point. You can go under the radar and the competition doesn't even know you're in there, because your partner is talking about what they offer, not what you offer. And that's the whole point. They don't have to talk about you. This isn't hardware, right? We're not kind of matching specifications, and we don't have a checklist here. Right, that's the whole point, to avoid having this checklist. Is, well, does it do this? Does it do that? Does it go as fast as the competition? Da 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 da. You completely eliminate that conversation from the sales cycle, and it makes it much easier for the partner to sell.
When developing these unique joint value propositions, mm-hmm. how do those contracts differ from one partner to another? Because there aren't going to be maybe two or three of the same partners or partner types that you would be partnering with as a vendor. Are there many differences? Is every contract unique because of the unique joint value proposition?
No, it does not affect the contract at all, because this is totally transparent in the whole transaction. The partner will buy from you, okay, and then you deliver your product when they want to sell it. The customer doesn't have to see anything any different, and the partner just has the regular terms. Now, obviously, we're talking here about a pure reseller relationship where the deal is done on the partner's paper. If you've got a different type of channel model where the deal goes through on your paper, then you could get into this scenario where you are comparing product with product, and then there's up to the partner to differentiate using their services in a different way, right? So yeah. that is definitely a possibility. But if the deal goes through on the partner paper, which in most cases it will, if you're going through a reseller partner in a foreign country, which is what this is what I do. I build distribution networks in foreign countries. Then 99% of the time it's going to go through on their paper, and so that doesn't affect the relationship or the contract you have with them.
When it comes to measuring the performance of each of the partners, mm-hmm. rather than just the sale of the product that they put in and wrap their services around, how else would you go by assessing the performance of a given partner within that joint value proposition?
That's a good question. I don't think that's something you need to worry about as long as they're pushing your product. Because at the end of the day, we're interested in how much they sell, not how they sell it, right? And so if they sell it as a default option in a, let's say, for example, we're dealing with a big GSI, right? And they've got their very clearly and uniquely defined data analysis offering, and by default, they slip in a 50K software license out of the $2 million deal. I really don't care. If they sell five of those a year, six of those a year, fantastic, right? Because it's a drop in the ocean for them. They're happy if it differentiates their offering in some way, shape, or form. Then everybody's happy. They make money. They should be making more money if they're using our product, right? It's not about making the margin, but it's about differentiating. So can they sell to different people? Can they sell more projects because they incorporate our product in what they do? And then that forms part of their unique value proposition. Yeah, so I don't normally think about that. So okay. Can we get it out the door and, you know, can we help them do it?
So it would come down really to get to that stage where you as a vendor want to be that default product in their, you know, larger scale project.
Absolutely. So what I like to see, Masha, I like to see my partners have a value proposition, which is like their key value proposition. And I know that my product gets sold every time they sell a project for that.
Mm. Yeah. Now, getting there is probably quite hard, right? Especially when you think about GSIs.
Yeah, sure.
I mean, they pretty much sell anything that's available, right? And based on what the customer needs are, they put those things together.
It's a much longer journey with them. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. So if you were a vendor thinking of going to the market via the channel for the very first time, and you want to leverage the concept of unique joint value proposition, mm-hmm. what type of partners would you be looking at first?
Well, there are usual suspects, right? There are usual suspects that, as I said before, they talk about what you talk about with the people you talk to, okay? So those are always going to be the first companies you approach. But then you differentiate between them by asking them about what's your go-to-market, why do you want to talk to us? What value can we bring together to the customer? How can we help you differentiate? Yeah. And going back to the other qualifying questions, like what's your vision of the relationship? How can how do you think we can do this differently? How can we make this into something? And this final point is very, very important, because how can we develop something which is unique to us too? Because what does a partner want? Do they want to be one more reseller and one more company that gets a quarterly call to say, how are you doing? Have you sold anything yet? Or do they want a really solid long-term relationship where they're entwined with you and they know that if they're successful, you'll support them. And the more successful they are, the more support they will get, because you've both got some skin in the game. This is what all channel partners want. They don't want to be just one out of 400 companies that receive a quarterly telephone call. They want to feel the importance of the relationship, and that you're behind them, and that you're doing things, special things, to help make them successful. And at the end of the day, this could even be accepting ideas from them to change the way the product is built. If you do this, then we can sell X more, right? No one's gonna argue with that. But if they've got confidence in the partner, they've got a track record of selling stuff.
I think it's quite obvious when you're a partner that receives a call from a vendor once a quarter, you're just one of their salespeople, and that's that, right? They're just they're just asking for numbers, right? The relationship and the value proposition doesn't really exist there.
I'd recommend your listeners to go to my recent LinkedIn post, Got Any Good News?
Perfect. We're going to link.
Which you kindly supported.
Yes, we're going to link to this, to that LinkedIn post in the show notes. So just go scroll down and you'll find the link to that post. Would you have any parting thoughts on the value proposition before I ask you, I think, the last question?
Well, I think that it really focuses the partner's mind on why they're working with you, okay? And it helps you understand why they're working with you. And if you don't like the reason why, so I mentioned earlier on, it's like, well, we just want a backup in case our chosen vendor doesn't come up with the goods. I'm not interested. So, it helps you qualify. It just accelerates and intensifies the conversation and gets you focused in the right places.
Perfect. Thank you very much for that, Phil. And the question I ask of every single guest.
Uh-huh.
What's the one thing you wish you knew before you started your career in channel?
I think the one thing I found out a little bit too late was the why. Why are you working with us? I think if I'd found that out earlier on in my career, I could have probably done a better job in two of my roles. Unless you understand this, it's the same. In this respect, it's the same as when you're in direct sales. If you understand why the absolute definitive why is the customer interested in what you've got, then you're halfway to the sale, right? And in channel, it's halfway to having a great relationship. If you don't understand why they want to do this, then nothing you do will ever make sense to them. And if it doesn't make sense to them, you're not going to get any airtime. And the key thing you need from your channel partner is airtime. You need their attention all the time.
Absolutely. Excellent. Phil, thank you so much for joining me on the podcast. I thoroughly enjoyed this conversation. It's been an absolute pleasure having you on the podcast.
Thanks ever so much, Mashi. It's been a pleasure to be your guest. Thank you.
And that's a wrap for this episode. I do hope you found it valuable. And if you did, please make sure to subscribe and leave a review. You can also follow Channel Voices Podcast on LinkedIn, Twitter, and Facebook. Or just visit channelvoices.com, where you can send me a message or leave a voicemail. All of the links are listed in the show notes. And once again, I appreciate you tuning in today. Until next time.